Lots of stuff going on all over the place. There's always an area of ministry that you can be a part of. There's always some piece of the puzzle that each person is able to be a part of. And I want to encourage you, find a place that you can serve. Whether it's greeting somebody at the door when they come in or whatever, find a place to serve. How many of you have ever heard of the Dead Sea? Has anybody here ever floated in it? Okay, I hear it's very, the water's very kind of thickish, you know, because it doesn't, well, it's the Dead Sea for a reason. Nothing lives in it. And it has water that comes in with life, and every bit of that life that comes in dies because there's nothing going out of it. There's no outgo. And I want to encourage you, have an outflow of your life. Be involved in something where you give of your life to other people, whether it's, like I said, greeting, saying hi, some area that you are a part of. God has blessed us, and we continue to grow forward as a church body, as a group of people in community together, and it's exciting to be able to see all the wonderful things that God continues to do. And one of the things that we have the opportunity to do as we grow forward in God is to grow in leadership together. And we know that the Scripture tells us that God sets within the body authority, and God gives those in authority wisdom to work together to move the kingdom of God together forward in a local area. And God has blessed us here at Healing Waters. We have, do you know, let me tell you this, you may not have known this. I meant to say this to the folks in the first service. Now you get to say to all those in the first service that you were told this and they didn't get told this. Do you know that Healing Waters has something that no other community has, no other church has, no other state has, and no other country has? Did you know that? And it's you. It's you. I believe that Healing Waters has some of the best people on the planet. And well, thank you for two people. That everybody else is like, well, I don't know. I just don't know about all that. Look, my wife and I, we're in our 18th year, and I can tell you that every year there's been another miracle, and you are a part of that. And as we grow, it's important to be a part of that. And this morning, you get to be a part of that growth process. As we the council and I have met and have gone through the process, and this morning it is an honor of mine to present to you a candidate for the church council that will, following services today, take place immediately. But it is my honor to bring to this platform Roy Simmons and his wife Mary. And would you make them welcome as they come on the stage with me this morning? You know, one of the things that you do is you grow and you learn is no two things look alike. Our two services don't look alike. If you're in the first service, second service, everything always seems to have its own, and that's good. That's a good thing. But as we grow, one of the important pieces of our growth is the church council, and the church council works with me to really provide oversight in every aspect of the church, physically, mentally, and spiritually. It is something that is not taken lightly. It is something that I believe is a sacred trust because of what God has called us to do together. Now, with that sacred trust, I come to you as the body. And the council and I, the council unanimously recommending Roy Simmons for this council seat, we bring to you now as the body to ask for your vote of approval, or, unfortunately, the other side of that would be a vote to simply defer and find another candidate. Now, you as the body have that option as well. But they have, in the time they've been here, which has been a significant time, we have observed their lives, we have watched them, we have heard their heart, we have seen their faithfulness, we've seen their attentive hearts to detail and for care for the body, even in times that most of you don't even know what's going on. And so that is why I bring them to you today. And I actually had one person wanted to know why I didn't give them the opportunity to verbally object to you earlier.
I bet I can guess.
Well, I'm not going to share a name.
Bobby.
But you know how that goes. But I'm going to ask you, the body, this morning. Is there anybody, on a serious nature, is there anybody that would have a fair and just cause of why Roy would not be qualified to serve in a council seat here at Healing Waters Worship Center? I know these are awkward moments, but you have to do this. Okay, good. It's awkward, me dragging it out, isn't it? I'm going to ask you this morning if you will stand behind them as they stand behind me in helping to lead this church to where we're headed, along with the pastoral staff and all the leaders together. If you will affirm their role as his role as a new council member, and of course his wife alongside of him, would you please signify that by standing this morning? And I'm going to ask any council members that are in this service, I meant to ask this earlier and it slipped by me, if any council members are in the service, if they would join me on the platform at this time, and any pastoral staff, that we would pray over them and ask the Lord to bless them in their role as we walk together in community, as we partner together in the kingdom, and as we continue to see God do great things, of which I believe our greatest days are still ahead of us. You say, even after almost 18 years, you still believe your great... I do. I believe our greatest days are still ahead of us. And I'm going to ask you, if you would, to please stretch your hands towards them, and let's ask God to bless them and to bless our partnership together as we move forward. Father, thank you for the privilege that we have to come together. I ask you, O God, that the spirit of wisdom, the spirit of understanding and of counsel and of might, God, would be upon them. I pray, God, that you would increase their compassion towards people. Lord, I know it's there. You've gifted them. You've blessed them. And I pray, God, that you would use them in a significant way. I pray, God, that as you join our hearts and hands together in partnership, that you would give us innovative ideas. Give us ideas of ways to do things better, to do things, God, in a more efficient way. And as we grow forward, our commitment to you is always that we will give you the honor and the glory carefully, understanding that it is you that sets up authority. It is not man. It is given by your hand, O God. And so we set them forward today. We thank you, Lord, for their commitment to you. We affirm Roy today in his role as a new council member. And I pray, God, that your hand of anointing would be upon him and his wife as they help to lead in this congregation. Let their light be life to all that they encounter, and use them greatly. I know, God, that only heaven will tell the true story of all that you've accomplished in this place. We bless them today, and we sanction them forth for the work of the ministry that you've called us together here in this place from this day forward to accomplish. In Jesus' name, amen. Mm-hmm. And amen. 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 Well, you may be seated, Roy.
Good morning. First, I do want to just thank you guys for being an awesome body of folks. You guys have such care and have made me and Mary feel at home, and we just feel very blessed for that. I do want you to know that this is something that we take very seriously. It's something that we hold in high regard, and I don't really do anything halfway. I was sharing this morning that my wife and my kids won't wash the car with me because they don't want to spend the 6 hours. Anyways, so I do commit to serve, seek God's will, God's wisdom. I didn't share this earlier, but Mary and I have been talking and praying because we really do feel like there's something about to occur. We feel that that there's going to be a breakthrough in this country, in the challenging times, and in this church. And it's been our heart that God would prepare us as a church to be ready for that, to be ready to train and teach the folks here and receive the folks that come in. So it's something that has been very heavy on us. We can't put our finger on it, but we just know what's going on. And of course, we just want to be a part of that and do what we can. And as you guys know, my awesome wife, the wind beneath my sails, she is just so awesome. So. Thank you guys so much. Thank you for caring for me, and thank you for affirming me today. I appreciate it.
Thank you. Thank you, guys. If you have your Bibles, I want us to go very quickly to John chapter 6. Is everybody awake? All right. John, the 6th chapter is where we're going to go. I cannot and could not this last week, since Wednesday night, get a portion of Scripture out of my heart. Once again, it was a small part of our Wednesday night series on the bait of Satan, dealing with offenses. By the way, how many of you have ever dealt with being offended? Now I have gone through this series probably a dozen times personally. And every single time that I go through it, something new captivates my heart that I need to apply or use in my life. And John chapter 6 jumped out at me once again. And I want to kind of take a journey with you this morning, for not too terribly long, maybe an hour. No, I'm kidding. John chapter 6. Beginning in verse 24, and I'm not going to read the entire chapter, but I will refer to the remaining parts of the chapter. John chapter 6, beginning in verse 24, it says, "When the people therefore saw that Jesus was not there, nor his disciples, they also got into boats and came to Capernaum seeking Jesus. And when they found him on the other side of the sea, they said to him, 'Rabbi, when did you come here?' And Jesus answered and said to them, 'Most assuredly, I say to you, you seek me not because you saw the signs, but because you ate of the loaves and were filled.'" Verse 27, "Do not labor for the food which perishes, but for the food that endures to everlasting life." Say everlasting life. "Which the Son of Man will give you, because God the Father has set his seal upon him." Verse 28, "Then they said to him, 'What shall we do that we may work the works of God?'" Seems like a pretty cool conversation, doesn't it? Man, what do we have to do what you do, is what they're saying. "We want to do what you do." Verse 29, "Then Jesus answered and said to them, 'This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he sent.'" Father, would you add your blessing, your anointing to your word this morning? Let it be life and liberty to all of us that hear it. Help us to understand today the real reason we must seek you. Let it not be for any superficial reason or any surface reason or any selfish reason, but let us come after you with a pure and passionate heart, knowing that you are indeed the author and finisher of our faith. Captivate our hearts and minds today in your word. Speak to us that we might glorify you in the midst of all things, through Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen and amen. I got a question for you today. And most of the time, this is a question that comes up during the holiday season, Christmas time. We'll hear words like, "Wise men still seek him." How many of you have heard that? And it kind of becomes cliche a little bit. Wise men still seek him, and it's put everywhere. But why do you seek him? Why do you seek after the Lord? What is it that draws you or causes you to want a relationship with the Lord? Now, we're going to unpack quite a bit of stuff today in this small portion of Scripture. Let's kind of zoom out a little bit so that you understand the context. In the first part of chapter 6, the Bible tells us that Jesus has come to an area, and he comes to this area and there are thousands of people. The Bible tells us there are 5,000 men, but there also are women and children. Now, some families had 6 to 7 children. Could you imagine, great God? 6 to 7 children, and they've got them all in tow, and they're all sitting there. And so some scholars say that the crowd could have been upwards of 20,000 people. Now, I want you to keep in mind as well, they did not have the things that we have today. PA systems, speakers, microphones. So it would take a good amount of time to relay a message from the front to the back. Now, in thinking about that, the same would be true back in the day for the children of Israel. When Moses would speak, it had to filter its way all the way through millions of people. But in this case, there's about 20,000 or so people, and Jesus is standing there, and they've all gathered together. And why are they there? Well, it's quite simple. Jesus had been going around the towns, and he had been healing all that were sick and afflicted. And word began to travel about Jesus and how he was this miracle worker and how he was able to do all this wonderful stuff. And so curiosity begins to build in the hearts of a heart of an individual that says, "Ooh, I wonder what I will see if I can just get close to him. I wonder what I can see him do for everybody else." And so these people that came to him, who later in chapter 6 the Bible calls disciples, keep in mind, they originally started coming around Jesus because of what he could do for somebody else. They were intrigued at what he was able to do. He was able to heal somebody over here. He was able to deliver this one and give food for this one. And now they've all gathered to him, and little Johnny on the front row says, "Mama, I'm hungry." And Mama says, "Shut up, boy. He's still talking." And they're trying, "We don't have any food. We didn't bring a snack with us. We didn't pack the crackers. We didn't have the goldfish. We don't know what to do." And then all of a sudden, the disciples realize, "There's no food here. How much money you got? We don't have enough money to feed all of these people." Now, they originally came because of what Jesus was able to do for somebody else. But then Jesus says, "Walk to the disciples," and we know this through the other gospel accounts. He says, "Well, what do you have left?" And we know that they had 5 loaves and 2 fish, right? You've heard me refer to it as the Happy Meal from Long John Silver's. It's enough for a little lad to have lunch that day. So there's little small, baked small loaves of bread, real small, in there, and a couple small fish. And Jesus blesses it, and he breaks it. And guess what? It is the greatest thing. You think Golden Corral is big. You think Old Country Buffet back in the day was big. This was the buffet of all buffets. Because he split loaves and he broke fish down, and thousands of people had more than enough to eat. This was a miracle. This is a flat out, no doubt about it, miracle. So they came at first to follow him because of what he could do for somebody else. But then they stayed with him because of what he could do for them. If you fast forward through the story, Jesus says to his disciples, "Hey, get in the boat, go over there." And the disciples are like, "What?" They get in the boat, a great wind comes up. Jesus comes walking on the water, right? And they're like, "Oh, it's a ghost." And Jesus says, "What, are you kidding me? It's me. You don't recognize?" No, that's not in your King James. But that's the dial. He's like, "Well, it's me. You know, are you kidding? You don't recognize me?" And he gets in the boat, and everything dies down. And so they come over, and they dock the boat they're on. And the sun's coming up, and guess what? There's the people. They'd watched them. They knew where they were going. They watched him. They watched Jesus get out of the boat. And when he gets out of the boat, the Bible tells us that there are still a great multitude of people that are there. Now, why are they there? Well, they started following him because of what he did for everybody else. And that's usually your biggest fan base. Well, it's kind of like, anybody ever heard of bandwagoners? It's like cowboy or redskin fans. They're bandwagoners. You know what I mean? You know, they get, "Nah, I'm a cowboy fan." Well, of course you're a cowboy fan. You only lost one game. Had to get that one in. Y'all know I'm just playing. I can't say anything about my team. Y'all know 49ers, we've gone down. But your broadest 10, I've gotten joked on before because at one point I may have been turning towards the Redskins, but I got cleansed and sanctified and got turned aside. No, I'm kidding. I'm just kidding. But, you know, the biggest fan base are those that are just there for everything connected with the event. You know, they're there for the party favors and the poppers and the hors d'oeuvres, and they are there. Everybody's fan. We're just a part of the group, you know. We're a big, happy group family. Yeah, it's great. And then they move from that to now Jesus had directly done something to impact them. I want you to interestingly note, not everybody that Jesus directly impacts stays with him. Because let's just say that 50% of them stuck around. That means 50% of them would have left. Now, that's a speculative number, you understand, and it's subjective. However, most of them would have stayed because of the connection they had to what Jesus did for them. So they began with what they heard he could do for everybody else. They got closer when he said, let me break these fish and here's the food. And they got a little bit closer. And man, as they're getting close to him, they're like, listen, we want to do what you do. Tell us, how can we work the works of God? Seems like a great question, doesn't it? Yeah, tell me how, I've had people to ask me, tell me how I can be a preacher like you. Well, has God called you? Well, I don't know about all that. And I'm like, I've told some younger guys, I'm not too old myself, just turned 40, so I'm still, I think, fairly young. Had a conversation with somebody this week. They said, how long have you been there? I said, in our 18th year. They said, what? They said, well, you were a baby when you started. I was like, all right, don't you love labels? But you talk to people about your journey, and they start going, wow, look what, boy, I wish I could do this and be where you guys are. But it's amazing that people will want to be where you are but don't want to have to do what it took to get there, And I've had people say, I want to be a preacher like you. Well, are you called? Well, what does that mean? Well, do you have any education? Not that that's important, but you need it. Otherwise, you're going to sound like an idiot when you're trying to lead. You're going to misquote scripture and do all kinds. The blind will lead the blind right into the ditch. And people are like, well, I don't have to go through all that. So there's this thing today that says, give me something so I can be like somebody else. And unfortunately, in today's time, we've had moments where we've had services advertised across the country that says, if you want a divine enabling to go to the service, pay this person $1,000, they'll hit you on the head and you will be given the anointing that is on their life and you could do that. That's garbage. I'm sorry, and if some of you ascribe to that, you probably need to rethink that. You cannot buy the presence, anointing, and calling of God. You cannot do it. It's an impossibility. It's already been attempted. Peter turned around and said, look, man, take your money and go somewhere else. But the motives are always there. These people are like, look, you did this great, and can we have this power, and can we do this? And Jesus starts to notice an issue. And Jesus begins to notice a problem. And he says, I need to have a chat with you. Now, that's not in your King James, but this is what's happening. He said, I need to talk with you. And here's what I want to talk to you about. I want to talk to you about bread. And I want to talk to you about living bread. And they're like, wait a minute. We don't want to talk about bread. We want to talk about bread. I know y'all are like, what? They're saying, you want to talk about living bread, but we want to talk to you about manna, because you know what? Our fathers ate manna in the desert. Moses gave it to them, and our fathers. So we know about bread. Don't tell me about bread. And Jesus says, no, you really don't know about bread. I am the living bread. And they're like, what? You're the living bread? And he says, yeah, by the way, your fathers ate manna in the desert, and guess what? They died. So he's clearly identifying two separate things. But how many of you know that we sometimes are a little on the thick side? You ever been around somebody that's kind of thick in the head? You got to tell them 5 or 6 times and then they still don't get it. Well, there's a lot of those around Jesus at this time. Now watch this. He says to them, they ate the bread, the manna, and they died. First of all, did Moses give them bread in the wilderness? No. God gave them bread. Now, the perspective was wrong to begin with. It was God giving them bread and not Moses. Here's another fundamental problem you have in the kingdom. People will take things of God and attribute it to a person to where the glory goes on to an individual, and then everybody starts worshiping a person, and they're, oh, this person. You can't do that. God has to be the centerpiece. So he says, that was bread, but it wasn't bread like I'm talking about. And he says, I am the living bread. And he says, listen, unless you eat my flesh and drink my blood, he says, you have no life in you. And Jesus, and they're like, standing there, they're like, are you kidding me? Now, hold on a minute. We've been camped out all night long. You fed us, and we appreciated the free meal. We've been out here all night long, and now you want to talk this crazy stuff, eat your flesh and drink, but what is wrong? He's like, I want to talk to you about bread. I want you to understand, he's not talking about his physical body. He's talking about a spiritual principle of knowing and following him, not for what he does on the perimeter, not for what he does for you, but doing things after him because of who he is. Most of the time, people want to follow you for what you give them, and when the giving stops, your friends run out. But Jesus is trying to put a principle in place here that creates an identity to who he is and not what his function is. His identity is Savior, Messiah. He's King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He wants them to understand that, and he's trying to get them to just get it down in their soul. And how many people are there? Thousands. They're there, and they're looking at each other. And the Bible says that as soon as he has this chat with them, and he begins this dialogue with them, in verse 41 of our text, it says, the Jews complained about him. Now, what happened when Moses told the children of Israel where they were going? And the children of Israel, by the way, pillar of fire by night, pillar that kept them lit, kept the way lit, and it kept them warm, and there was a pillar of a cloud by day that kept them cool, and they saw the Red Sea stand up and dry ground, they saw manna and all kinds of miraculous stuff, and they still didn't believe. And the first thing they did, I know I'm drinking a lot of water today, I've been battling this stuff for 3 weeks, and it's still kind of hanging around, so we get through it together, but They had seen all this stuff, and they still didn't believe. And the first thing they did was complain. So here's what these people did to Jesus. They said, you know what? Our father Moses gave them manna in the desert. And they're complaining. They're doing the same thing that their fathers did in missing God in the moment. The children of Israel back in the day missed God in a moment, and they are getting ready to miss God as well. And he goes on this dialogue and he says, unless you eat my flesh and drink my blood, you have no life in you. Verse 54, he says, whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life. Here's what he's saying. He said, look, what I did for everybody over here, that was temporary. You know that food you just ate, the loaves and the fish? It was temporary. But I want to give you something that will solidify you through eternity, because your life is temporary and eternity is for a long time, and I want you to be saved for eternity and not just rescued for a small window of time, and I want you to know that. I want you to see that. And the Bible says in verse 60, it says, therefore, many of his disciples. Now, folks, a disciple is a very clear notation of the type of individuals that are there. Disciples are those that have made a commitment. Disciples are the ones that say, I believe and I'm going to follow, right? Why did they believe and follow? Because of the miracles on the fringes and the miracle of the meat and the bread to themselves. But now Jesus says, you know what? The lights and the fog are going away. We're turning the music off. We're taking the stuff off the video screens. We're taking your favorite worship set down, and I want to talk to you about what it is to know me. I want to talk to you about what it means to know me beyond what it is I provide for you. I want you to know me as Lord and Savior and Messiah, as the living bread from the inside that preserves the soul, and that is who I want you to know. And the disciples, many of them, the Bible says, said, this is a hard saying. That cough was fake, by the way. I wasn't getting choked. Just demonstrating here. They're probably like, Jesus, so what you're really saying is you don't want to do miracles for me anymore. And Jesus probably said, that's not what I'm saying. I want to give you the greatest miracle ever known to any person, and that is to save you from now all the way through eternity. And that's the reason I came. It's great that I gave you a miracle over here and then I blessed your meal, but I'm more than just your blessing over your meal. I'm more than just the miracle on the fringes. I'm more than a story in this book. It's more to me. I want to be your Savior to solidify your eternity. And they said, whoa, wait a second. This is a hard saying. They said, who can hear it? You say, well, that wasn't, they were just having a hard time. But if you go down a little bit further, the Bible says that after that, verse 61, he knew that he complained. His disciples, they followed him with reason. Verse 66 records some of the saddest words that you'll ever read penned in Scripture. It says, from that time on, many of them fell back and followed him no more. Now, thousands were around him. Tens of thousands followed him because of what they heard. They were fed, and now thousands stuck around because of what he could do for them. And when Jesus said, I don't want to do things for you. I want to do something on the inside of your life to seal you for eternity. They said, nah. And the Bible says that they fell back. Many of them fell back. Well, how many are many of them? Well, I don't know how many are, but what I can tell you is how many are left. The Bible says, verse 67, then Jesus said to the 12, now look at me for a moment. Understand the dynamic. You have Jesus in front of the group of people. There are no microphones, there are no PA systems, no video projection systems. There's no communication devices like what we have today. So Jesus is standing in front of the first group, and he's saying to them, I want you to know me. There's more than just what I can do for you and for your friends and your family. I want to do something on the inside. I want to make sure that your eternity is secured for all your time. And the front group of people go, I don't know if we can commit to that. And I want you to picture the front group gets up and they begin to walk. And the people behind them, as they're walking by, would probably say, hey, what are y'all leaving the service for? He's still up there preaching. What are y'all getting up for? And they're saying, he's not giving us any more food. He's not going to do any more miracles for us, so we're leaving. He's not doing any more miracles? Nah, come on. He talking about eternity and some other kind of crazy stuff. But here's the problem. They'd sat in the services in the synagogue. They'd heard the prophecies. They knew that this was him. It was written everywhere he went that this was him. He did the miracles that were, everything about him pointed to Messiah. And they're getting there, tapping their friend. And so from Jesus' point of view, could you imagine? He's standing there, and as he's speaking, people are slowly leaving the crowd. One by one, 10 after 10, 20 after 20, 50 after 50, 100. After 100, he's watching the crowd thin out. I don't know how long it took, but you talk about awkward. You thought it was awkward up here earlier. You talk about awkward. He's watching all those people leave, and he doesn't stop them. You would think that a loving Messiah would have said, all right, I'm going to call down fire. Y'all stop. Stop where you are. Here comes fire. Here it comes. But he didn't do it. You see, the danger in the American churches today is we've become so entertainment driven that we easily walk away from Jesus when the entertainment doesn't match up with what we think we should be getting. The pastor didn't do this. The worship team didn't do this. They're not swinging from the chandeliers. They're not acting crazy. They're not doing all this like that. Folks, just... I promise you that when the testing of your faith comes, the first thing you will not think about is who ran through a wall. Now, I know that's extreme and kind of funny sounding. The first thing that ought to be on the forefront of your mind is holding on because it's temporary. This is temporary. I can remember, and I recalled it in the first service. I can close my eyes, Sister Jackson, dear sweet saint of God that went to the old Tab Church when I was a young kid. I can still see her sitting there on the old pew in the foyer with her eyes closed, holding a young person, singing a song, encouraging them to hold on to Jesus. Today, we want to encourage people to go after miracles and go after this. Folks, just we need to stop all that. We are so hungry after the things of God that we'll make it appear like it's God. We've got churches, and I guess I am being critical, and I'm not trying to be ugly, but we don't need laser shows and fog machines and all this stuff to come fill in the sanctuary, to set the ambiotic mood for people so they can worship. You don't need all that. My goodness, they didn't have all that in Scripture. I know we have certain luxuries that we probably take advantage of, but, there comes a point where idolatry slips in very, very quietly, and you start looking at people, and you start looking at worship, and you start looking at a person doing for you, and then all of a sudden when they don't do for you, you fall back and follow no more. And the danger is, what do you do when the miracle runs out? You say, huh? Because we quantify miracles. We don't understand the greatest miracle that could ever be formed in a person's heart is that they come to know Christ Jesus as Lord and Savior and believe on Him. And the Bible says, when you do, you shall be saved. But we got all this other prerequisite stuff that we throw out there. Well, if I believe in the Lord, then so-and-so, then this shouldn't happen. And I've had people that have said to me, well, how can you trust God after everything you've been through and after all you blah, 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 and all you've lost? And how can you this and how can you that? And my answer is, how can I not? Because He's the one that sustained me when you lost a child, when you lost certain things in family, and you went through difficult times. He's the one that sustained me and kept me from losing my mind. That's why I didn't go crazy, is because of Him. I had I not had Him, I'd have lost it a long time ago. And some of you would have been in there with me. And I'll start to close with this. And Jesus says, He looks to the 12 and He goes, and I can see the frustration in the question. Look what He says, verse 67. Jesus turns to the 12. What does He say to them? He said, you want to leave too? It's an honest question. Are you going to leave too? Watch what happens. Simon Peter answered and said, to whom shall we go? He didn't say, what shall we do or where should we go? He's very specific and He says, to whom? And when He says to whom, He identified the very reason the 12 were able to stay. He said, we've come to believe and know that You are that Christ, the Son of the living God. Now look, I'll be honest with you. I know God can heal bodies. I know God can deliver. I've seen Him do all kinds of stuff. I know God's able to do all things. I know He is. But the greatest miracle of all, the greatest one of all, is when Jesus is born on the inside of your life and you come to the belief and knowledge of Him as Lord and Savior, and you know that He laid down His life for you, that He shed every ounce of blood for you. He died and was laid in a borrowed tomb for you. On the third day, He arose and He ascended to the right hand of the Father, making intercession for you. That is the core of who we are. That is the core of who I am. And listen to me, that is the greatest miracle that anyone could ever have. I don't care if you raised the dead and did all that. None of that matters. What matters is where you go after you're dead. Don't matter if you can raise them back up. Where are you going after? And Jesus says, you going to leave too? They said, no. We don't have anyone else to go to that has words like you have. And you know the story. 11 faithful following Judas's fall turned the world upside down. And we are reading in pages today because of what God, but I can't help but wonder, what would the world have looked like had the thousands stayed and not left? There are going to be times that you won't always agree in the church setting. Let's just be honest. You're not always going to agree with programs and particulars. But we can agree on the person of Christ Jesus. And as long as we're not violating biblical mandates, and as long as we're not going out there and leading a world astray, why spend time fighting over foolish things? Now, I'm not saying we do that, because God's been with us in a very gracious way over these last many, many, many years. But you know what? There's still that stuff that rises up in any of us when we, A, don't get our way or something. And I just want to encourage you today, let's not make the kingdom about the fringes and the stuff that we can just get ourselves. Let's make the kingdom of God solely about Jesus Christ, and understand that the greatest thing that takes place in our lives every week is our connectivity with one another, because Christ in you encourages Christ in me. And as a believer in God, I tell you, I got up this morning, all this stuff is still in my forefront. I don't know what somebody put in my sinus cavity to feel like this for 3 weeks, but it's still there. But you know, as soon as I walked through that door and people started coming in, it was like someone breathed life into my soul. And you've got to understand, you are strength to each other. You really are. You're strength to me. We are strength to others. And I believe our greatest days are ahead. Not because we'll have all the greatest glitz and glam and pomp and circumstance. No, I believe the greatest days are ahead because we have a great message and hope of who our Lord and Savior is, Jesus Christ, and that He's able to reach down to the lowest valley, and He's able to pull us out, and He's able to pull us out of the miry clay and establish our goings. He is indeed the reason for my existence. So I ask you again, why do you seek Him? Is it for the fringes? Is it for the benefits? Or is it because of who He is? I can't answer that for you, but only you can. Would you stand? I know you've got stuff to drop off on your way out today and signing up for the Christmas party and stuff. You don't want to forget about all that and go to the Welcome Center and get all that stuff straight, because we got to order all that food and all that kind of stuff and nominating. And it's fun to nominate a male or a female for Man of the Year and Woman of the Year. Never done it before. We're doing it first. It's going to be a lot of fun. All that stuff's great. But the greatest thing of all is being able to lay our head down at night and know beyond a shadow of a doubt that Christ has risen in our heart and in our lives, and that we have been saved. So I'm going to ask you this morning, as you say, did you do this first service? I can tell you no. I didn't feel directed to, but I feel directed here. And I'm not going to tell you to bow your eyes and close your head. So if you're here for the first time, I said it correctly. A lot of times we'll bow our eyes and close our head up and say, let's just get out of here. You're here this morning, straight, laser-like specific. You've not been following Jesus for the right reasons. Now, I'm not going to ask you what level it is, but just some things have been a little, and maybe it's not been right reasons. But today, you're going to make a first step towards your eternity. And you say, well, I can do this at my seat. No, ma'am, and no, sir. You know why I say that? Christ couldn't be crucified from His seat. He had to step out of eternity. He had to take steps forward. And if He can walk that far for me, then surely I can walk a distance for Him. When we step out of our seat, and I know a lot of times we wrestle with it, why does that guy call people to the altar? Because it causes you to engage your faith. If you don't engage your faith, it'll just go dormant. And so that step engages our faith. So I'm asking, is there a man? Is there a woman? Is there a young person? Is there anybody that'll say today, I want to follow Jesus for the right reason, starting right now? And if that's you, get out of your seat and as quickly as you can come up to this altar. I want to follow Him for the right reasons, beginning right now. Step out of your seat and come up to the front. Come on, I know you're here. I know you're here. He wouldn't have stopped me and got me to do it like this had you not been here. I know we're always waiting for somebody to step out. Tell me to close my eyes and I'll step out of my seat. No, I'm not going to do it. because this is nothing to be ashamed of. Today starts a new beginning for some of you. Today. But if you don't, the difficult part is Jesus' point was not a miracle. It was eternity. You know why? Because he knew many of those people would walk out of that service that day and they never see him again. It was about eternity. And so with compassion and urgency, I ask again. I know this is hard. I know it makes us feel embarrassed. This is not meant to make you feel embarrassed. But we've got to engage our faith. Is there anybody that will engage their faith today and be bold enough to say, today, from this moment on, I'm going to serve him for the right reason? Then I'm going to stand right here and I'm going to wait on you just for a few more moments. I know it's awkward, isn't it? But I just know what I know. I just know what I know. I'm going to engage my faith today. I'm going to engage my faith today. I'm going to engage my faith today. I'm going to engage my faith. Anybody else? I'm going to engage my faith. You know, eternity to us right now doesn't seem too long. But I've been at the bedside of many people that have gone on to be with the Lord. And to them, eternity seems mighty long. And this temporary seems like such a flash, even though it's the exact opposite when we're living in the temporary. It's like, is this ever going to quit? Ask some of our leaders, council, come and stand with these, and we're going to pray. And if by chance you're here, and this is the only time I'll ever grant permission to do this, because you know how I feel about it. If while we're praying over here, you're like, I'd like to sneak up there because my heart's beating real fast, and I know I need to be up there, then while we're over here praying, you can feel free to sneak on up here. But we're going to talk to God together. Father, I thank you for your word today. I thank you for what you're doing in our lives. We want to follow you for the right reasons. We want to serve you for the right reasons. We want to know you for the right reasons. We don't want to be the people on the fringes. We want to know you for the right reasons. God, we want to solidify eternity. I know the temporary is difficult. I know the temporary drives us crazy. I know the temporary rubs us the wrong way. But today, we lay it all aside, and we will not be one of those that walk away from your invitation. But we'll say to you, yes, Lord. And Lord, not only for these, but to every one of the household of faith that has made their calling and election sure. I ask you, Lord, that you would touch us today and allow us to live in the experiential frame of our faith. Let us live and dwell and move as people of faith that know you, that rely on you, and as we do so, we don't crumble because of life. Let our faith in you be alive. Let our confidence in you be alive. And I just declare to you, Lord, all over again, and I invite every person that would to join me in this declaration. Lord, I declare it in my life afresh today. I believe in you as my Savior, Jesus. I believe in you. You laid your life down for me. I believe you. You love me first. I believe you. I believe you died for me. You rose again for me. Lord, you know my shortcomings and my frailties. And I ask you, Lord, that the frailties and the shortcomings, forgive me for the moments that I failed you. Forgive me for the moments that I walked away or waned in my own faith. Forgive me for those moments, oh God. And I ask you, create in me a clean heart, oh God, and put upon me a right spirit, renewed in your faith. Your word says, oh God, that as we come to know you through Christ Jesus, that you do a rejuvenating work on the inside of us. Behold, the all things that are old, they pass away, and everything becomes new. Make us new creations in you, Jesus. And as you do, we'll be careful to follow you all of our days. And we declare you are Jesus Christ, our Lord. And that is why we seek you. Hallelujah. Blessed be your name, O God. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name. That's why we seek him. For who he is. Now, as they're still standing there praying, they're good, let them pray. Let me give you some instructions. One, as you make ready to depart today, remember those several things. Man or woman of the year, just something new we're doing. It's kind of cool. And registering for the Christmas party, they'll help you back there. If you've got any trouble even with that, cost or whatever, see Bobby. We'll work stuff out. It's a great time. But understand this. The day has come that we really have to live our faith. We do. In our frustration, in our difficulties, we have to live our faith. It has to be a reality. And people are watching us. And they want to see the joy. I know we get frustrated. Trust me, I know. But they want to see, do you have the goods? Or are you just another fleeting, you know, testimony? May God help us to be the real deal. And may God bless you and your family as we continue on this journey to be what God's called us to be. Let's seek him for the right reasons, okay? We love you all so very much. They'll help you as you go today. Have a wonderful day in the Lord. And if for some reason you needed special prayer and maybe something that particularly facing you wasn't addressed, there'll be some folks down here that would be happy to join with you in prayer also, okay? Have a wonderful day in the Lord. Bless you. Have a great day. Amen.